So, straight off the bat, I want to say that this game is being marketed in a really weird way. Nearly every media outlet is touting this one as a Souls-like RPG with God of War combat, when in actual fact, it's more God of War-like with a hint of Souls-like elements to it. And while that statement may sound somewhat redundant, I believe it is a more accurate summary of the game and better describes how it actually plays. Going into this one, I had to set and reset my expectations multiple times. But to understand what I mean, we need to go back to the Xbox Showcase of 2022. From that initial reveal trailer, we got our first look at Flintlock, the Siege of Dawn. Just ignore that early 2023 release date. Oh boy, were they wrong. It is here that I caught my first glimpse of a game that I thought was Xbox's answer to God of War. I was like, oh yeah, cool, Xbox has an awesome third-person over-the-shoulder, narrative-driven action-adventure game. But that's only half of the truth. For starters, it's not exclusive to Xbox. It is coming to PlayStation and PC as well. And secondly, if you pay attention to the newer trailer from this year, it's being advertised as a souls-lite. Now, I don't know the exact difference between a souls-like and a souls-lite. I believe a souls-like is more closer to the formula of Dark Souls than a souls-lite, but I believe a souls clone is more soulsy than a souls-like. It's all a bit arbitrary if you ask me. But what I do know is that all these subgenres simply indicate some level of inspiration from the From Software games, albeit to varying degrees. So this game being advertised as a souls-lite really threw me for a loop. Judging purely from the gameplay trailer, there's no way it looks anything like a Souls game. But there it is, souls-lite, staring us straight in the face. Now this is not a knock on the game, it's just a bit misleading is all. In my opinion, them using souls-lite to market this game is more detrimental to the interests of the mainstream audience. Lately, the term souls-like is followed with fatigue. Most people are tired of these Souls-inspired experiences. Not me though, I fucking love them. Bring them on, I say. Getting back to my point, I did not expect this game to have any Souls-like elements, but I was pleasantly surprised by how well they mix with that God of War style gameplay. And the God of War influence goes deeper than just the over-the-shoulder perspective and axe-wielding protagonist. Right from the get-go, you are paired up with Enki, one of the many gods that made it through this sort of underworld portal which opened 10 years ago. Enki works very similarly to how Atreus functions in God of War. A tap of the triangle button sees the character swoop down for a quick attack, dealing prime damage. A sort of stun build-up, kinda like Atreus would loose an arrow to stumble the stunner selected target. Another similarity between these two games is the "Kill All Gods" tagline. This no doubt indicates a story of revenge between Nor, our hero, and the gods that now inhabit this world. The prospect of hunting down and slaying these gods is extremely enticing to me. It's been a while since I played a game with a setup that's clear and to the point as, gods have hurt you, now you must hurt them. I want to bring up the glaring similarity between God of War and Flintlock, that is the over-the-shoulder axe-rigging action. Does it often look like God of War? Yes. Does it play like God of War? No. Do I expect it to though? Not really. Look, I know it's unfair to compare these two games as A44 is only a fraction the size of Santa Monica Studio, but it's hard not to draw a comparison when the game has clearly taken an inspiration from God of War. The feel of actually striking an enemy in this game is a bit weightless. Yeah, it sounds chunky when you connect, but control feels a bit floaty and disconnected. The best way I can compare it is, if you've ever played The Witcher 3, a game that I consider one of the best action RPGs ever, combat feels very much on par with that level of quality. Look, I really love The Witcher, but let's be honest, combat was never its strongest suit. I feel the same about this game. Combat is by no means bad, but I wouldn't mind an improvement in reaction animations and feedback. In addition to swinging your axe around like a madman, you're encouraged to incorporate your pistol into the flow of combat. This game is called Flintlock after all. One way they do this is by equipping enemies with a break attack. These are indicated by a flash of red before playing out. They cannot be blocked or parried, but they can be countered with a shot from your trusty pistol. A pistol counter usually stops the enemy dead in their tracks or straight out knocks them flat on their asses. Bullets replenish as you attack enemies with your axe, so mixing shots in with your combo is highly encouraged. Speaking of combos, I have no idea why this game has a combo system. To me, it feels odd to include in a game like this, but no doubt many other people will welcome this feature with open arms. Personally, it does nothing but highlight my failures whenever I fail to bank the XP. The way it works is, you gain XP, or reputation as it's called in this game, by defeating your enemies. Pulling off flashy moves while doing so will add a percentage multiplier to your score. These moves include things like dodging, dashing, blocking, shooting, parrying, and more. The more moves you use, the higher your multiplier will grow. You can do this for as long as you want. So if you're good enough, you can potentially rack up dozens of kills and boost all that XP with a huge multiplier. To bank it, you're gonna have to hold the left button on the D-pad. Doing so will reset the counter and you're free to build it up again. Getting hit at any time during the combo will reset the multiplier and bank the base XP gained from defeating those enemies. It's honestly a great way to introduce some high risk, high reward gameplay. I just hope it's not necessary to master the combat in order to see the full range of her abilities. Here's another place where I see a similarity to God of War. As you gain XP, you'll want to spend it on unlocking powerful new abilities. These abilities are split into three main skill trees: Powder, Magic, and Steel. Powder pertains to ranged attacks, Magic improves Enki's presence on the battlefield, and Steel refers to the axe-based maneuvers. I'm interested to see how these spice up the combat as you progress. From what I can see, you can get some really powerful moves early on, one of which simply trivialized what I believe was an in-game encounter. Well, for the demo anyway, but more on that later. For now, let's talk hamlets. As the description says, these are small communities that have been seized by hostiles, and killing the enemy's leader results in the hamlet being restored to a safe haven for the inhabitants to return. Doing so unlocks a fast travel point for the player, and also rather a unique vendor. One that I can only describe as if Laura from the Evil Within series trimmed her nails and got a day job. Just look at the creepy design of this character. What's even more creepy is its awakening animation.
Leaving so soon?
I absolutely love the unsettling yet approachable design of this character. It looks like something pulled straight out of Studio Ghibli, or Ghibli, or Djibouti. I'm just gonna move on from this statement before I dig a deeper hole. But getting back to the vendor. Apart from upgrading your maximum health vials, they will sometimes clue you in on nearby side quests. As for what they sell, in this demo it only seems to be cosmetic items, like different colored pants or jackets. I just hope the full game expands on this. And while we're on the topic of clothing, let's talk about gear. Throughout your adventure, you will come across powerful gear that will shape and refine your playstyle, offering buffs to your weapons and abilities. These come in the form of helmets, pauldrons, and gauntlets. A very God of War-esque feature if you ask me. Additionally, you can chop and change your firearms and axes for a more tailored character build. For example, I found an axe that creates a fire buildup on enemies, and striking them with a heavy attack causes that buildup to detonate, dealing massive damage. Another one is the Herald Blade, which was a reward for defeating a rather beefy endgame boss of this demo. Dude had a crap ton of health and hits like a truck, but I managed to defeat him rather easily after investing in a... you know what? In an ability. I can't read my own writing. But I managed to defeat him rather easily after investing in an ability that allows you to counter with a pistol after a well-timed parry. Executing this move keeps the boss flat on his back for most of the fight, leaving him open for you to take his ass down to Blast Town.
Not gay sex.
Oh! In the chest he was guarding, you'll find the Herald Blade, a weapon that seems to be ideal for farming XP, as it awards a bonus multiplier when attacking enemies with a charged attack. I should mention, these weapons can be upgraded by collecting resources such as iron, wood, and sulfur, and taking them to Baz, your traveling companion, who will perform the upgrade. This gear and upgrade system is nothing to write home about really. but I'm confident the ability upgrades will compensate for that, as I can already see the potential for powerful builds in this limiting demo alone. Now, I don't know exactly how I want to structure this, but I want to talk about the Souls-like influence on this game. When we hear Souls-like, or Souls-lite, we immediately paint a mental image of an inhospitable world, slow and deliberate combat, harsh and punishing environments, and a screen that says, "You died," the words of which are practically etched into the back of our eyelids, reminding us that we need to get good. When it comes to Flintlock, you'll struggle to find any of the traditional tropes usually associated with a Souls-like. The only instance where you'll see any resemblance to a Souls-like is in its level progression. As you progress through the world, you will come across checkpoints, or lodestones as they call it. There you can rest, which will respawn defeated enemies, and also replenish your health vials. So these essentially act as bonfires, with the added benefit of managing ability upgrades. The only other similarity I can think of is when you die, you have to then recover your souls if you want to get your reputation back. But even as I write this, I'm struggling to make any connections between this and Souls games. I honestly thought I would have more to say about this topic, but unfortunately that's about it. What I can do is talk about how it is not like a Souls game, and that comes in the form of exploration and character movement. This has to be one of my favorite features of the game. Very early on, you'll unlock the ability to use gunpowder in your mobility. These enhance your jumps by extending the height and distance you can travel in a single leap. This kind of freedom in movement contradicts the philosophy of the games that inspired this one. I mean, it took From Software half a dozen games to finally add a dedicated jump button, not counting Sekiro. Or look at something like God of War, where the only vertical movement is like climbing chains or using lifts. These games place a huge emphasis on keeping the player grounded and keeping a character, well, slow. But boosting your way over rooftops and castle walls to uncover secrets and powerful items was extremely rewarding and fun. Before we get into this next segment, please consider subscribing if you enjoy this video essays I'm putting out. Look, I put out a video once every 2 or 3 weeks. I promise I won't blow up your subscription feed. Thanks for making it this fun. Let's get into the final thoughts. Okay, so Flintlock, Siege of Dawn. Where do I stand with this game? Firstly, I will 100% be playing this on release day come 18th of July. It is a day one Game Pass release for both Xbox and PC. So even if you are slightly interested in this one, there's a low barrier for entry and I'm positive you'll find at least something of value in this title. Do I think it's a perfect game? No. But do I think it'll provide an entertaining 20-ish hours or so? Yes, yes I do. By the way, 20 hours is only a guess. I'm willing to bet this game is as long as the latest Lords of the Fallen. Also, I should mention, this game does have a difficulty option. You can choose between story, normal, and possessed. So if you want to take it easy and experience the story as it unfolds, you can do just that. I reckon it'd be worth it just to see some of the cool enemy designs. Otherwise, if you hate yourself, there's always the possessed difficulty. I managed to beat it on both normal and possessed. Usually, I would play a game like this on hard, but I recommend normal for now, mainly because the combat itself is not the best feature of this game. Also, getting hit by this move while playing on hard was a real punch to the dick. Shit comes out of nowhere. Overall, Flintlock leaves me a bit mixed on the matter. If you ask me what my ideal game would be, I would probably tell you something like God of War meets Dark Souls. Just the weight and feel of God of War's combat system and how badass you feel when you chain everything together in your arsenal to do massive damage. Combine that with the unmatched boss designs of Souls games, then you have what I consider the perfect game. With that in mind, Flintlock attempts to do just that, and correct me if I'm wrong, they are one of the first to combine these two worlds. But as much as I appreciate them trying to do this, in the back of my mind I'm always going to compare this game to God of War, and rather unfairly to be frank. Still though, it's a great achievement for a team that's a fraction the size of Santa Monica Studios, with a fraction of the budget as well. Well, that's it for this one. I want to thank you if you made it this far. Leave a like if you like it, dislike if you didn't, you know the deal. Subscribe if you're new, and I'll see you in the next one. Bye bye.